Welcome to ATCM, the emergency medicine channel. Today we are discussing about a case who came to emergency room with high BP, preeclampsia like features. We'll see what is the case. We'll discuss about the case. Can we start now?
Thank you, sir. A 32-week preemie gravida with 32 weeks of period of gestation was taken into ER with a history of headache for 1 day duration and worsening of pedal edema for 2 days duration.
A pregnant lady coming with headache. What are the differential diagnosis you can keep in your mind?
Sir, pregnant female presenting with headache, our striking features will be hypertension related to pregnancy.
Normally anybody can come with so many reasons for headache, simple reasons like migraine.
Yes.
That should be ruled. You should think all normal reasons first, then only go to unusual thing. Migraine, routine headaches, all these sinus. Tension headaches, so many things, sinusitis. Then unusual causes, but they are very important. What are the reasons?
Hypertension, thrombosis.
Okay, cortical thrombosis. Okay, so these are the two important things we should never miss: high BP and causing headache. Another one is cortical vein thrombosis. A very common presentation: severe headache in a pregnant lady with some ophthalmoplegia, vomiting sensation. We have to always suspect cortical venous thrombosis.
Yes. Okay. Our initial 10-second assessment, patient was conscious, oriented, obeying to commands, able to complete one full sentence. Then we proceeded with primary assessment. In parallel assessment of primary survey, her airway is patent, there is no secretions in oral cavity, C-spine is normal, there is no secretions or gurgling sounds, breathing, air entry is bilaterally equal, there is no crepitations or wheeze, respiratory rate is 18 cycles per minute, normal pattern. Circulation, BP is 180 on 130 millimeters of mercury, pulse rate is 84 beats per minute.
What is the, like how many months over now?
32 weeks.
Do you think 32. That 18 is correct, your recorded breaths properly?
Yes. Huh? Sometimes because of gravid uterus, patient can be tachypneic.
Most of the pregnant ladies will have a higher rate than normal. It's a physiology. When we are telling 17 that there may be, either you are wrong or there may be some issue. So you should present carefully.
Disability, GCS is E4, V5, M6, pupils are 2.5 millimeter equally reacting to light. Exposure temperature is 97.4 Fahrenheit, sugars are 181 milligram per deciliter. In management of primary survey, patient was kept in a propped up position, patient was kept in a comfortable position and two large bore IV cannulas are secured. Warm blankets are given to avoid hypothermia. We asked for a pain score. Pain score she graded 2 to 3 out of 10. And we offered analgesics. She deferred to it. Then
what analgesics? Suppose the patient is agreeing for your analgesics. What analgesics you can give?
Better analgesic for this patient will be paracetamol, sir.
Okay. Safer is paracetamol.
Yes.
What is the position of comfort at this stage for this patient?
The patient is having gravid uterus, sir. So we can put little bit head end elevated at 15 degrees and minimal manual displacement of uterus or left lateral.
Conscious,
sir.
In this case, we can put in the
left lateral position.
The patient herself can lie down.
Yes.
Any pregnant lady towards the gravid term, always better. The patient is conscious, has here to lie down on the left lateral.
Left lateral.
Even pre-oxygenation, oxygenation, everything can be done with a little slight head up tilt. So that uterus will not be compressing and causing the splinting action over the diaphragm.
Yes.
Oh, normally what happened to the tidal volume in pregnancy?
Sir, because of raised diaphragm, functional residual capacity will get reduced, sir. Okay. But because of progesterone, sometime tidal volume can increase also, sir.
Okay. So that's when the tidal volume decreases, normally pregnant ladies will have some amount of increased breathing to compensate that. So that we should keep in mind.
Rate of respiration will be
slightly more when you compare normal person to a pregnant lady. It will be more.
Yes. Then ample history. Patient is not having any allergies. Medication, she is a known case of pre-gestational diabetes on insulin. She is taking human atropine 15-15 and 10 and NPH 0-0 and 15 units. She is also a known case of hypothyroid on thyronorm 75 micrograms. Last meal, she had consumed clear liquids 2 hours back and soft diet at 3 hours back. Her menstrual history, LMP is 28th of February and EDC is 5th of December.
Okay, so 2 more months are there.
Yes.
Okay.
then Premi, sir, Premi. Events leading to this cyst is, she is complaining of headache for 1 day duration. Headache is not radiating. More, there is no complaints of visual disturbance or central scotoma. There is no photophobia. There is no weakness or swaying to one side. Patient doesn't complain of any vomiting or seizure episodes. There is no loss of consciousness. There is no reduced activity. Patient complaints are also, pedal edema is also present, which is gradually progressing in the past 2 days. There is no history of abdomen pain. There is no history of shortness of breath. Sir, this is the positive clinical history, sir. Then I would like to examine the patient, sir.
What is your comment about the pedal edema?
Sir, pedal edema usually in late term we can have because of uterus compressing on IVC.
Normal pregnant lady itself can have pedal edema. That is very important to understand. But there are some conditions where there is an abnormal physiology and produce pedal edema. What are the conditions?
Other abnormal things what we can see is already patient is a chronic renal failure patient. Then
more than that, simple things, anemia. Most of the pregnant anemia ladies are anemic. They can have
pedal edema.
Okay, then.
Then.
Hypothyroidism can produce pedal edema. Then.
DVT.
Yeah, that is unilateral, bilateral causes.
Dilution.
Preeclampsia, eclampsia, hypertension, cardiac failure. So many reasons are there. So we have to, once you see the pedal edema, you have to evaluate. If simple reason for pregnancy itself can produce pedal edema, but there are multiple complicated reasons also can be there. Can this hypothyroidism produce pedal edema like this in pregnant lady? And if that produces, what should you do for the thyroid hormone replacement therapy? Anti-TPO antibodies simply tells you that it's an immune-mediated hypothyroidism. That's all. It will not tell you how much tablet you have to give. Dose will not be told by the test.
Should optimize the thyronorm level in pregnancy. There can be.
Okay. Now, suppose somebody is taking 100 microgram thyronorm. Normally, when they become pregnant, they may require
higher dose.
At least 50% they may require additional dose. That sometimes it will not be monitored properly. Many patients come with hypothyroid state in pregnancy. So when you have a patient like this, look for TSH. TSH should be towards the lower limit of the normal. Okay.
So what other points should you keep in mind regarding the patient with hypothyroidism in administration of the drugs pertaining to the rapid sequence intervention or any other?
Drug should be given in empty stomach if patient is having rilution.
No, sorry, is asking RSI, any change in hypothyroid?
They will be more sensitive for the sedative drugs.
Yes.
And for the temporary thermoregulation.
Hypothermia.
See, they have to protect the from going for hypothermia.
Yes. Okay.
In neurological system examination, her higher mental functions, she is conscious, oriented, obeying to commands, speech and language, memory, everything is intact. Motor system examination, bulk is normal.
Normally, in a pregnant lady who comes with vomiting, severe vomiting, early phases, what neurological abnormalities common?
Pregnant lady
comes with severe vomiting. What neurological abnormalities common?
The B12 deficiency. Sir.
Thiamine
deficiency.
Thiamine deficiency can occur in some patients. Okay.
Then bulk. It's normal. Patient is having normal tone. Power, both upper limb and lower limbs, 5x5 power is there. Reflexes, both superficial and deep reflexes are present. Cranial nerve examination is essentially within normal limit. There is a cerebellar system
examination. What is the need of documenting deep tendon reflexes in a preeclampsia patient?
Sir, once we started magnesium therapy, we have to monitor deep tendon reflexes.
You should know what is the baseline reflex in the knee jerk, at least in the knee jerk, before starting magnesium.
Then second, we would like to examine abdomen, sir. Abdomen is soft, bowel sounds are present, uterus corresponds to period of gestation, fetal heart we could get with stethoscope, sir.
Okay.
Cardiovascular system and respiratory systems are within normal limits, sir. At this time we have to evaluate and we have to manage, sir. In management part, we have given Nicard for BP is 180 on 130, that is coming in severe. Patient is having BP of 180 on 130, sir. That is severe preeclampsia.
Okay.
Preeclampsia is BP of anything more than 140 on 90 millimeters of mercury, which two readings we have to take minimum of 4 hours apart with proteinuria, with or without proteinuria, with or without with endargon damage. These things should be there.
Suppose the patient is having non-hypertension.
Yes.
Then it comes in preeclampsia stage.
If a patient is having a hypertension before, now she is developing new onset of proteinuria,
okay,
then she will be fitting under preeclampsia criteria, sir.
Okay.
This so.
Renal monitor will be done thinking about at this stage.
Fetal heart rate monitoring we have to do, sir.
Fetal monitoring should always be initially started. As soon as the patient is coming, we have to continuously watch the changes in the fetal.
Yes, sir. So our provisional diagnosis will be preeclampsia or chronic hypertension superimposed with preeclampsia will be our diagnosis, sir. Then we would like to evaluate this patient, sir. First we have to send routine bloods like CBC, sir. CBCs we are looking for, one is anemia related cardiac failure, second thing is platelets, sir, because in HELLP syndrome platelets can be low.
Okay.
Second thing is liver function test, sir. In liver function test, transaminitis elevation more than 2 times the normal, it is indication of liver damage, or again it also can elevated in HELLP syndrome, sir.
Okay.
Then renal function test we have to check. Renal function test, creatinine of more than 1.1 or increased more than 2 times the baseline, then that is indication for endargon damage of kidney, that we have to monitor, sir.
Okay.
Then urine routine we have to see. In urine routine, if there is a proteinuria of more than 2+, then it points more towards
the problem with proteinuria is many pregnant ladies will have proteinuria as a physiological response. So it's all you put all this together, then only as a emergency doctor we can make it as a preeclampsia. Only proteinuria, then we'll be in difficult, like whether it is a physiological or pathological, we may not be knowing. But overall clinical picture associated with BP, pedal edema, proteinuria, all these things together only we should make a diagnosis of this eclampsia, preeclampsia.
Yes, sir. Then in management part, we have given tablet Nicardia 20 mg we have given, sir, and we asked for monitoring of BP every
day. Is nifedipine.
Nifedipine.
Okay.
Uh-huh.
What is the duration of nifedipine when you are giving for hypertension? How much time it will act? What are the disadvantages of nifedipine? It's a good drug. If you know the side effects, then you can manage it also.
Neutral tachycardia.
Tachycardia.
It can produce
tachycardia.
That is the only major adverse effect of nifedipine. It can produce tachycardia. So in many conditions, nifedipine is not used nowadays. Okay.
Yes, sir. That was given, and we asked for a serial BP monitoring, sir.
Okay.
Every half an hourly we monitored BP. BP started to reduce. Initial BP was 180 on 130. Second BP reading was 160 on 110. Then third BP reading was 150 on 110 millimeters of mercury,
okay,
sir. Then
what are the BP antihypertensive you can use in pregnancy?
In pregnancy, we can, drugs available will be labetalol, then hydralazine, then nifedipine, sir. Then labetalol doses.
What are the drugs you can use? My question is, what all drugs you can use?
Calcium channel blockers, beta blockers can be used, sir. Arteriovenous dilators can be used.
Or what are the contraindicated?
Contraindicated is ACE inhibitors and
ARBs.
Except
ACE, ARB, all drugs can be used in pregnancy, whatever may be the stage. Okay. Depending on the level of BP, you may use powerful drugs or less powerful drugs. Okay.
Labetalol usual dose is 20 mg we can give, sir.
Mm-hmm.
That we can give as either as 5-5,
mm-hmm,
or we can directly give with 20 mg.
What is a what class of drug is labetalol?
It is both alpha plus beta.
Okay. So this is one beta blocker has got additional alpha action. So that will be, that can control BP better than any other beta blockers.
Yes. Then we can repeat BP repeat the dose of labetalol every 10 minutes based on our BP target, sir.
Okay.
Up to a cumulative dose of 300 mg, that is the maximum dose we can give.
Okay.
If after 300 mg also we are not able to control BP, then we have to switch over to next step.
Okay.
Then labetalol infusion is also possible, sir. If we are planning for labetalol infusion, then 1 to 2 mg per minute infusion we have to start based on our target.
Long acting drug or short acting?
Short acting.
Labetalol is one short acting drugs. We prefer all short acting drugs in emergency room.
Okay. Yes, sir. Then
intra-arterial BP monitoring
that is important.
Yes. Then second drug will be hydralazine, sir.
Okay.
Hydralazine, if IV hydralazine is available, then 5 mg is the start dose, sir. Then we can repeat IV hydralazine every 20 minutes up to a cumulative dose of 30.
Okay.
That will be for idolescence. Then nifedipine also we can give, sir. Nifedipine 20 mg we can give, that last for 2 hours, effects will be there for okay. BP, sir. Okay. These are the other drugs available, sir. Sir, BP of more than 160 is severe preeclampsia, sir. So anything we have to control and bring less than 140, sir. Diastolic BP of 140 or 90.
So then always you have to monitor the fetal circulation also. Whenever reducing the BP, that may also be the advice.
Yes, sir. These are the BP medications available, sir.
Okay. Now, if you have a now this is preeclampsia, you are treated well and control the BP. That is more than enough. But if somebody come with eclampsia, seizures, what is the treatment of option? And somebody delivers and BP persisting, then what is the treatment of?
If a patient is having seizures in front of you, then termination of pregnancy will be ideal, ideal, sir. So patient have to be taken for C-section. In meanwhile, what we can start is, we can start magnesium sulfate, sir. Okay. Magnesium sulfate, both IV and IM doses are available. If you are giving us IV means, then 6 gram of magnesium sulfate we can give a start dose. Then we can continue infusion as 1 to 2 gram per hour infusion we can start.
Okay.
In this infusion time, we have to monitor for deep tendon reflux, because in magnesium toxicity, deep tendon reflux is the first thing that is going to get abolished.
Okay.
And always target a magnesium level of less than 9.
Okay.
That will be our target. What? So based on that level of magnesium, toxicity appears. If it is 7 to 10 means patient can have abolished deep tendon reflexes. If it is up to 15 means patient will have respiratory depression, that is bradycardia we can see. If it is up to 20 means patient can have some unstable arrhythmias. If it is more than 25 means patient will have cardiac arrest.
Okay.
These are the signs.
We should be very careful in giving magnesium in eclampsia patients.
Yes. This
okay.
This is IV preparation for magnesium sulfate,
okay.
Sir. Then IM preparation is also available. If we are giving IM means 5 gram of magnesium sulfate we will give in each buttock region, that is in alternative buttocks we will give. After that we can give repeat dose 5 grams every 4 hourly, sir.
Okay.
But it can be painful.
Okay. If a patient does not improve with your magnesium, the seizure part, we are not treating actually the BP part with magnesium. Magnesium has got some vasodilatory actions, but here we are not treating the BP part, we are actually treating the neurological part with magnesium. It has got some effect on the blood vessel also. If the neurological part is not improving, patient still have seizures, ideal thing is
to
you take the patient for C-section. But meanwhile, in between, should we do something else, intubate the patient, what are the drugs you can use, correct?
Yes. If you are planning for rapid sequence intubation, first we will start from positioning, sir. Position is, patient should be in supine position with minimal head and tilt up to 15 to 20 degrees, and manual displacement of uterus we have to do, sir. That is one thing. Then we have to anticipate a difficult airway, because of abdomen is already unprepared, sir. Then patient have seizures, so some amount of secretions will be there in oral cavity. Then while intubating also, patient can have vocal cords edema. Those things we have to check. And one smaller size tube, we have to get it ready, sir. And
pregnancy induced changes plus hypothyroidism itself may cause edema of the respiratory passage also.
Yes, sir.
One smaller size.
Yes, sir. Then in drugs, we have to
oxygenation.
Yes,
don't forget.
Yes, sir.
We need here more.
Yes, sir.
Because the pre-oxygenation will compensate for the
apneic episode.
Yes. Okay.
Yes. Pre-oxygenation, we will start maintain a saturation of 100%, sir. Then while giving drugs preferred will be alpha-fentanyl and etomidate and rocuronium, sir.
Etomidate, better choice. Any other thing? Ketamine can be used.
BP will
be given. Ketamine better will get involved. Okay, etomidate.
Then this will be for induction, sir, and one tube size smaller we have to have.
Induction part is over, muscle relaxation.
Muscle relaxation, we will prefer rocuronium of 1 mg per kg we will use, sir.
Better we go for succinylcholine. It's very short acting. And easily eliminated from the body. Okay. Succinylcholine is very preferable, unless otherwise there is no contraindication. Next choice better than rocuronium. The drug will take little extra time. Only thing adrocuronium or cisetrocuronium. Okay, self elimination better than rocuronium. Any other thing?
Then when to get neural?
Sir is asking after intubation, how do you set the ventilator settings?
Yes. In ventilators, patient will be having pushed up diaphragm, so that usual tidal volume we might not achieve. So we will target a lower of 6 mL/kg of body weight we can do. Then whatever possible things we can do, we can keep patient in reverse tidal volume so that uterus will be little bit down and we can manually displace uterus so that adequate tidal volume we can achieve. Then rest everything saturation we will target more than 94% we will target the saturations.
Okay. So after delivery, suppose the BP persists, after delivery also BP persists. So before delivery BP is there, normally we give magnesium and take the patient for cesarean. BP management has got lesser role actually in eclampsia, because the eclampsia will be terminated by only by your delivery, not by BP medication. May reduce little bit, but after delivery if the BP persists, then there is a role for active management in BP control. How do you manage it?
Yes, post delivery it is not like what we are doing pre delivery. So post delivery if BP say, we have to rapidly act on it and we have to reduce BP. Okay.
That's actually a medical emergency. Yes. Other one is a surgical emergency. You do the surgery, immediately patient will recover. This one you have to intervene medically, otherwise it will not improve. Okay. What drugs are preferable in this condition?
Again, in emergency room, what we can practice only short acting drugs.
Okay.
Preferred will be labetalol.
Labetalol infusion will be ideal for this type of patients, because whenever you want to stop, you can stop it. If you give a drug like metoprolol, you give 5 mg, the action will be longer, prolonged. The other one, once you stop the infusion within half an hour to 20 minutes, it will become normal. Okay. Then.
After the delivery, what are the agents you will use for the uterine tonic contraction of the expulsion of the placenta? What usually you use, what should not be used? Methergen and oxytocin. So methergen should not be used, it will further increase the BP. Okay, suddenly it will. So oxytocin is the one in charge.
Then,
if the creatinine is elevated when you are using magnesium, is there any
magnesium? Okay, so urine output should be continuously monitored.
Okay.
When we are using magnesium.
Mainly when you are giving magnesium, if the creatinine is high, you may not be able to use this much high dose.
If patient is having already a creatinine issue or kidney issues, then start dose mostly it won't have anything.
No,
but
correct.
Infusion dose, what we can do, we can reduce to half the
dose.
Usual dose and we can give, and
okay.
Meanwhile we can monitor for urine output and deep tendon reflexes.
One
more thing, when you use magnesium, you have to keep in mind about the non-depolarizing muscle reactions. The reaction will be potentiated.
Okay.
So this drug should be used in smaller dosage at longer intervals.
Then if a patient develops signs of magnesium toxicity, we have to revert it to calcium gluconate.
Okay, that is very important.
Calcium gluconate, if you are giving, means it is 15 to 30 mg of 10% calcium gluconate we can give us in infusion over 10 to 15 minutes. If calcium chloride, means it will be 5 to 10 ml.
Calcium chloride is
three times
potent than this one in its action. Okay.
Yes.
Anything else you want to take care of? What is the role of aspirin in pre-eclampsia? Is there any role?
Yes sir, aspirin is usually
used by many doctors, and it is there in some guidelines. Okay. The aspirin can be used. Okay.
What are the complications do you expect a preeclampsia may lead on to?
Sir, a preeclampsia patient can have oligohydramnios. In that, baby will have IUGR. Then a preeclampsia per se, it is not an indication for taking patient for C-section. If there is any obstetric indication which is pressing on C-section, then only we will take for cesarean section. Then it might itself alter placental vasculature and it can increase blood pressure. It can precipitate gestational diabetes. These are the other things.
Complications are abruption.
Abruption.
And precipitating into eclampsia. Pre-time delivery.
Eclampsia.
Sir, the major stress syndrome.
Yes.
Because of the hypertension or renal shutdown or liver functions are deranged. And what about the blood picture? Platelet count may be low.
Low.
And if it goes into the help syndrome, means coagulopathy, low platelet, liver failure, no, everything.
Another complications of this one is also coagulopathy. Okay. So these are all things you have to anticipate and
be prepared. How is the patient now?
Sir, after initial management, we have given, since it is patient have crossed 32 weeks, we have given steroids, sir. Steroid, okay. Betamethasone of 12 mg we have given for
okay.
lung maturity of fetus,
okay.
and repeat dose we are planning after 24 hours.
BP is controlled now?
BP is controlled.
What is the drug she is taking now?
She is on nifedipine, sir.
Okay, nifedipine, retard or plain?
Sir, plain, sir.
Plain. Okay, plain means how many times you have to give it in a day?
Sir, two.
Sixth hour.
Plain is 6th hour. Sixth it acts hour. For 6 hour. Retard means at least two. BD you can give. Okay, that we should remember. Most of the time what happens is nifedipine plain tablets is given as BD. That will act only for 6 hours. That will produce reflex hypertension. Suddenly the drug control will go and the BP will surge. So that should be avoided. If you are giving nifedipine simple tablet, plain tablet, 6 hours. Retard tablets means BD or sometimes 3 times some doctors give, but BD is more than enough. That should be kept in mind. Okay.
Thank you.
After the delivery, take care of the baby, whether baby is having normal breathing or depressed or apneic. So accordingly, baby resuscitation set should be ready and we should be prepared for an intervention and ventilate the patient as long as the baby starts breathing.
Hypothyroidism will have some problem on babies.
Yes.
So that also should be kept in mind. Anyway, your gynecologist will take care of all these things, but we as PG in emergency medicine should know the complications. When we talk to the bystanders before they come, gynecologist come, we have to tell all these things. Otherwise the complicated delivery, sometimes baby can go wrong and there will be some problem in that case. So we have to talk everything in detail to the bystander. Okay, thank you.
Thank you.